Now, there are just a couple more things we need to talk about before we actually construct this hypothesis test, and one of them is the whole idea behind type 1 and type 2 errors. Now, a hypothesis test is actually what's known as or referred to as an indirect proof. Researchers gather data in hopes that the data will contain sufficient evidence to suggest the null hypothesis is false. If the null hypothesis is shown to be unlikely or false, then the alternative hypothesis, the only other choice, is therefore more likely. And actually, rather than false, you may want to substitute this or substitute the word unlikely. The more unlikely, the more reasonably we can think that it is actually false. Now, an important idea here is that we cannot actually prove anything with the hypothesis test. Rather, what we hope to do is to suggest the likelihood based on probabilities. So all this would be based on, ultimately, all these decisions would be based on probabilities. When you complete a hypothesis test, you will always either reject or fail to reject the null hypothesis. Always. You complete a hypothesis test, you ultimately reject the null hypothesis in favor of the alternative being more likely, or you will fail to reject the null hypothesis, which says you can't suggest the alternative is more likely. Now, the bottom line is that the null hypothesis in reality is either true or it's false. Whatever the null hypothesis states, it's either accurate or it's not. It's really that simple. Now, we will base this on probabilities, and specifically, we'll be using what's known as a p-value. A p-value is the probability of observing a test statistic at least as extreme as was actually observed. Now, a p-value is typically thought of as the calculated probability of a type 1 error. And actually, I should, probably shouldn't hyphen that. There we go. Now, it's not the same as a type 1 error, but we think of it as being very similar to a type 1 error. So, what is a type 1 error? Well, the null hypothesis, like we said either or earlier, is either true or false. Now, you're going to make a decision. That decision will be either to reject the null hypothesis or fail to reject. If you reject the null hypothesis when the null hypothesis is true, that's bad. That's an error. And this is what we refer to as a type 1 error. Rejecting when it's true is not good. And we can help control for this by specifying alpha. It's the same alpha you come to love and adore back when you did confidence intervals. It's the same guy. So if I say alpha is 0.05 as an example, then what I'm saying is that I'm willing to set or accept a 5% risk of rejecting when I should not have. Now, if you reject the null hypothesis is false, that's good. You want to do that. The probability of that would be 1 minus alpha. See, this is very closely related to the idea of confidence interval. So if alpha is 0.05, let's just say it's 0.05, 1 minus alpha is 0.95. That means if you reject the null hypothesis with an alpha of 0.05, you're saying there's a 5% chance that you did the wrong thing, but a 95% chance that you did the right thing. Now, if the null hypothesis is false, you really do want to reject it. If you fail to reject it, that's also bad. And this is what's known as a type 2 error. And this we use beta to represent the probability. And that means failing to reject when it's true, which is a good thing, is 1 minus beta. Now, we are not going to be working too much with this. Just I want you to know that 1 minus beta, because you may see this, is commonly referred to as the power of the test. Now, when we do our sample size calculations, we base our sample size on alpha. There are what's known as power calculations, which bases the sample size on 1 minus beta, the power of the test. We will not get into that in this class, but it is a common survey thing doing the social sciences. Social sciences very commonly do power calculations, and there are other areas that they're very useful. But we will not be getting into them here. So, let's take a look at a couple of setups here. First example, when a parachute is inspected, the inspector is looking for evidence the chute will not open. So, what would the null hypothesis be? Well, the status quo is that the chute opens. So, the null hypothesis would be chute will open. And your research hypothesis, what you're looking for evidence, is to show that the chute will not open. Okay, so what would a type 1 error be? A type 1 error would be rejecting. And when we reject, what we're really saying is we think this is false, leaving this as being more likely. So here, a type 1 error would be to say the chute will not open, but it would have. That would be my type 1 error. So the null hypothesis is true, but we rejected it. Okay, so what is a type 2 error? Here, the type 2 error will be failing to reject the null hypothesis when it's actually false. So here, a type 2 error will be you say the chute will open, but it will not. Well, which is worse? In this scenario, the type 2 error is much worse. You're saying the chute's going to open, you go throw it on somebody and throw them out of a plane and watch and see what happens, and the thing doesn't open, right? That would be bad. A type 1 error, you'd say that chute won't open, but it really would have. So that's like, well, maybe a slight inconvenience. You're saying this chute's not good, go get a different one. Okay, big deal. It's not that big of a deal. On the type 2 error here, you could kill somebody. So that could be a pretty serious mistake. Yeah, I know if you jump, you have a reserve and all that kind of stuff, but let's not get too deep into it. So you get the idea here. In this scenario, a type 2 error would be worse. And that's why. We just discuss why. So let's take a look at another example. When an ambulance crew arrives at the scene of a serious auto wreck, they're looking for evidence the injured person has died. If they believe the person is alive, they will continue working on them. So what would the null hypothesis be? The null hypothesis would be that they're alive. The alternative hypothesis would be that they're dead. So what would a type 1 error be? A type 1 error would be rejecting the null hypothesis when it was actually true. So if you're going to reject the null hypothesis, what you're actually saying is that you're saying they were dead, but they were actually alive. Okay, that's not good. What would a type 2 error be? Well, a type 2 error would be failing to reject when you should have. So a type 2 error would be they're saying that they're alive when actually dead. So in this scenario, which is more serious? Well, obviously the type 1 error. Because if you see that they're dead, when they're actually alive, you're going to leave them there, move on to the next person, right? Where type 2 error says, if you think they're alive, but they're actually dead, well, what's that mean? You go keep working on them. You're not going to do that person any more harm, right? Yes, you can get really deep into it and say, well, yeah, but what about the other people? They didn't go help them. That's not the point. Let's not make this complicated. Let's just stay with the basic idea here. Here, if you say the person's dead and they're actually alive and you leave them, they probably are dead now. But if you said that they're alive and they're actually dead, all you could do is work on them, you're wasting time. Clearly, the type 1 error in this scenario is much more serious for that reason. So in general, which is more serious, a type 1 or a type 2 error? And the answer is, I don't know, it's totally situation dependent. Some situations, a type 1 error is definitely much more serious. Other situations, a type 2 error is definitely much more serious. For this course, we will be protecting against a type 1 error only. Like I said, with power calculations, there are ways to help protect against type 2 errors, but in this course, we won't be doing that. So, just a couple more things before we actually start calculating hypothesis tests, or actually setting them up. So, let's go back to our cancer example. Suppose you believe the new treatment for a particular form of cancer will increase survival rate. The current average survival is 2.25 years. The average from your test of 13 subjects is 3.1 years. Is your treatment statistically better? That's the question we're trying to get to. Now, this is an example of a right-tailed test. And the reason being, if I draw a picture, which you should always do, the mean we believe is 2.25. Over here someplace is 3.1. And we're looking for this probability. This probability I mentioned earlier is actually the p-value. And we'll use this probability to make a decision. See, I'm going to the right. I'm looking at the right tail, hence the right tailed test. The null hypothesis was that the mean was equal to 2.25, and the alternative hypothesis was that the mean was greater than 2.25. That greater than indicates a right tailed test. A left tailed test would have an alternative hypothesis that says the mean is less than 2.25. In that case, we would have 2.25, our mean, and over here someplace x bar, wherever it is, would be to the left, and we're looking for that probability off to the left. Now, a two-tailed test, the null hypothesis would be that the mean is not equal to 2.25. In that scenario, you're saying, you know, I don't really have a feeling for the direction, I just think it's different from 2.25. So whatever x bar is, the sample mean up here, and then the negative of x bar down here. Actually, the negative of x bar is not true. Whatever distance is between this and x bar is the same distance here. It may not be the negative of x bar. It's just the same distance here. And then I'm looking at both tails. And then that would give me my two-tailed test. So those are your three options. Your null hypothesis, for my students, always be equals whatever value. And then the alternative hypothesis, you have to decide, is it greater than, less than, or not equal to? Now technically, I'll just do this briefly here. Technically, if I have a null alternative hypothesis of greater than, then I should have this. Mu is less than or equal to 2.25. That goes with the alternative that mu is greater than 2.25. If I have the alternative of mu is less than 2.25, then technically I should have mu is greater than or equal to 2.25. If I have the alternative that says mu is not equal to 2.25, then technically the null should be mu is equal to 2.25. Because these cover, each one of these combined covers every possibility. This covers every possibility. This covers every possibility. But again, for my students, what I'm strongly suggesting is you always use equals. Then you decide here what you're going to use. Because the equality here, once again, does not have an effect on the probability. The inequality down here absolutely has an effect on the probabilities. So technically this is correct, but this is what I prefer my students to do. It makes life so much easier.